two go hand in hand, of course, because slavery was the main reason why the Underground Railroad existed. So we're going to talk about slavery. Then we're going to talk about the rise of the abolitionist movement, what was happening in the United States that was leading people to assist folks to escape and try to become free. We're talking about one of the most obscure, one of the most important legal decisions the United States Supreme Court ever made concerning slavery. Anybody ever heard of Supreme Court of Pennsylvania? Raise your hand. So I thought, I usually ask this question, nobody's heard of it. And yet this is critical to understanding the Civil War and what happened. We're going to talk about York's attitudes towards slavery and towards escaped slaves. And then we're going to talk about the rise of the Underground Railroad, and we're going to talk about a few of York County's Underground Railroad sites. I have to preface this talk as an author by saying when I write Civil War books, it's really easy. There's a lot of information, and my hardest thing is to sort through the information and find out who's telling the truth. The problem with the Underground Railroad is it's illegal. People can leave lots of reports and lots of records that didn't conflict. They didn't really write anything down. So you've got to glean things through what written documentation does exist. There's a lot of houses and a lot of people that were involved in the York County Underground Railroad that we're not going to talk about tonight because we don't know who they were. We may have family stories that say my great-great-grandfather was involved. Probably was. I'm not here to dispute that. But I'm not here to confirm it either because there's only a few people we can actually verify were actually Underground Railroad conductors. I have a complete list of them in my book, and it's under 50 people in over a 50-year period. So not a lot of people that we can truly document. But there's a lot of folks we think were heavily involved or not. Now, one of the things that's very important to understand is how different slavery was in Maryland versus Pennsylvania. Because this is what's going to trigger the Underground Railroad in our region. So, slavery in Maryland, there's two key points. One is in 1664, Maryland passed a very important law. It's got one of the books. It says that if you are born to a slave mother, you are a slave for life. If you're already a slave, you're a slave for life as well. And the second law, equally important, passed in 1753, says your owner can't let you go. Can't let you go without the state legislature officially approving. Now, the reason why Maryland did this is because a lot of slave owners were fairly clever. We bought these people, we're using these people as laborers, and then when the slave gets too old to work in the fields or to work in the house, they just cast them out. Just throw them off to the side. No food, no clothing, no nothing, just cast them aside. So Maryland legislature says, you know, we gotta at least do something to protect the slaves. So they now say, you're a slave for life and the master can never get rid of you unless. So that's Maryland. Now Pennsylvania's gonna follow a totally different track. Pennsylvania actually has slaves before Maryland. Did you guys know that? Slavery started in PA before it started in Maryland and before it started in Georgia, before it started in North Carolina, before it started in South Carolina. Pennsylvania had slaves before that. First slaves from Pennsylvania came in 1684, came into Philadelphia and dumped off 150 surviving African-American people. Several people died on the way over, but 150 are known to have been sold when that ship arrived. Now, as we all know, Pennsylvania was founded by William Penn and the Quakers. Now, the Quakers had a fairly tolerant attitude, in fact, towards slavery. William Penn, in fact, he never owned slaves, but he used slave labor. The contractors who were building his house that he had on the north side of Philadelphia certainly used slave labor to construct Penn's own house. Penn leaves, goes back to England. His kids and his grandkids will eventually take over Pennsylvania. While this is going on, in 1688, in Germantown, a group of German Quakers, now they were converted from the Mennonite religion, to become Quakers, they, as Mennonites, were devoutly opposed to slavery. The Mennonites, the Moravians, the Anabaptists, the Dunkards, the German Brethren, the German Reformed, a lot of these Anabaptist-type denominations for Germany were devoutly anti-slavery, devoutly. And that attitude started percolating into the Germantown Quaker community, where these converts who moved in from Germany, and then they started to finally slip back into England. And by 1754, The Quaker Church had its first hardcore abolitionist here in North America. His name was John Woolman. John Woolman came through this area, came to York County, in fact, at least once, maybe twice. But he came here and was preaching in the Quaker Church over in Newburytown about the evils of slavery and how slavery needed to stop. So the Quakers are starting to get more and more militant. And as they are starting to get more militant, as the American Revolution and the whole concept of freedom and throwing off the British yoke becomes more and more important here in Pennsylvania, so is the idea that we need to throw off the yoke of slavery. So if we want to be free from England, well, these African American people should be free as well. And really, really got a lot of impetus when highly publicized two of the most important non-Quaker Pennsylvanians released their slaves and came out as anti-slavery. One, of course, is Benjamin Franklin, and the other one is John Dickinson of Dickinson College fame. So they start feeding the whole anti-slavery movement. While this is going on, the Pennsylvania Anti-Slavery Society, which a number of Quakers in Philadelphia had started, are getting pretty heavily involved in trying to push for abolition. They're trying to help sue for freedom with people who've escaped to this area. While all this is going on, we're fighting a war with the British, of course. In 1776, we declare our independence. 1777, Vermont is not a state, by the way. Vermont's not one of the original 13 colonies. It's the state number 14. But Vermont was part of New York during the American Revolution, although they were kind of independent. But as they're preparing to become a new state, to become the 14th state, they write their constitution without slavery, and they abolish slavery forever. So Vermont technically is the only state that came in before 1860 that technically never allowed slavery. Well, Pennsylvania's got 6,000 slaves during the American Revolution. Putting that in perspective, that's more slaves from here than in most of the Deep South. So North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, more slaves in Pennsylvania than in those areas. And of course, Mississippi, Texas, Arkansas, Louisiana, Florida, the big slave states didn't exist at this point in time. So Pennsylvania's had three arguments. One, slavery's fine, don't worry about it. Second argument is slavery's evil, and we need to get rid of slavery right now. Caught in the middle are all those business people who have already bought slaves, 6,000 of them, many of which are very prominent Philadelphians, and they say, look, time out. This isn't fair. We spent a lot of money on these slaves. We just can't let them go. So Pennsylvania compromises, and they pass the first law called the Gradual Abolition Act. And what it does, it says, number one, no new slaves can come to Pennsylvania, so you know we're done. You can't bring anybody else in this. So Philadelphia slave trade, that's over. But here's the key point. Any child born in Pennsylvania after this date, the effective date was November 1st, 1780. Any child born after that date, first year you had to be an indentured servant, not a slave, indentured servant for 28 years. If you're born then, obviously, in 1781, it would drop by a year until 1808. If you're born in the year 1808, you're free. Anybody born in Pennsylvania, anybody here born after 1808? This law's still in the books. So if you're born in Pennsylvania after 1808, you're free. That's good to know. We don't have to worry about becoming slaves. Now, what about these poor people who are born before that date? Now, Pennsylvania brings a couple of things to bear. One is, if you're born before this date, then you are a slave for life, much like Maryland. But they made it different. One of the things, when I moved here from Ohio in 2001, one of the stunning things to me was how much Pennsylvania taxes its citizens. I had to pay a tax to come work here, and things like that. Well, taxes in Pennsylvania are nothing new. So if you wanted to have a slave back in that day, you registered, you got a license for your slave, and you paid a tax called the slave tax, of course, and you paid that every year. The first year you didn't pay your taxes, what did the government do? Take your slave. Just like if you don't pay your regular taxes, things haven't changed. So, as long as you kept the registration up on your slaves, you could keep them as slaves. If you chose just to release them, just don't pay your taxes. You also could sell them. You had the option that if we don't want the slave anymore, we'll simply let the slave go. Now, here's another hugely, hugely key point. If you came into Pennsylvania from out of state and you're a slave, if you could work here or live here for 6 months, you're automatically now a Pennsylvania citizen. And as a Pennsylvania citizen, you're free from slavery, no matter what. So that's a key point. You just had to get to Pennsylvania and live here or work here for 6 months and you're free. Now, here's the problem. United States Congress meets where? Philadelphia. And of course, a lot of the congressmen, James Madison, James Monroe, Thomas Jefferson, people like that, what? Owned slaves. And they certainly weren't going to come to Pennsylvania and not bring their household servants. They're not going to bring their personal butlers, their drivers, their horse groomers. So they exempted all Philadelphia congressmen. As long as you were in Philadelphia attending a session or directly moving between your home state and Pennsylvania to either go home from an executive session or come to a session. So if you're George Washington and you're going to take your slave for a ride out in the countryside, that slave could be free. The slave had to stay in Philadelphia or have some legal reason to actually go with you. Otherwise, you weren't going to get rid of that slave at all. All right, so here's York County. We've talked a lot about the country. Pennsylvania had 6,000 slaves, 10% of them lived in York County. There were 657 at the peak, 657 known slaves who were here in York County. The number one place was Peach Bottom, believe it or not. There were more slaves in Peach Bottom than anywhere else. There were 39. Slaves recorded in the very first census of York County in 1783. Now, I want to caution you, when I talk about York County in 1783, York County then went from the Susquehanna River to South Mountain. So what's today Adams County was part of York County. So York County's numbers do include Gettysburg and places like that. However, there weren't a lot of slaves in that area. There were some, certainly, but certainly not as much here. And of course, the tax records, you had to list your slaves. And I just chose one at random. This is Elizabeth Chastings, because she lived up here in this general area over in Newberry Township. She had a distillery, 7 Negro slaves, 6 horses, 7 cows, and 20 sheep. So again, you listed your slaves with all your other personal property. And you pay taxes on every cow you own, every sheep you own, every Negro you own, you pay taxes on everything. That's the way, unfortunately, the law was set up. Very unfortunate, but that's the law of Pennsylvania at the time. Well, the Quakers think this is abominable. The Quakers in Newberry Town, obviously she lives in Newberry Township, but the Quakers in Newberry Town, in Warrington, and in Lewisberry, and in York, the 4 major Quaker concourses in York County are appalled by this whole idea, and there's lots of anti-slavery meetings that occur in the old courthouse in downtown York, then on the square, of course, and complaining about we've got to get rid of slavery here locally. So and the local people start responding. That's 1783. In just 7 years, half the slaves are gone in Pennsylvania. They've been freed. And now we drop from 695 to 77 in York County. York County leads the movement in terms of freeing slaves. Although we're York Countyans, right? In a lot of cases, we didn't free the slaves. We took them to Baltimore and sold them. We won the money. So York, there's a lot of records of York County slaves being taken to Maryland during that period of time and being sold. Cadorus Furnace, some of you may be familiar with that. That was built predominantly with slave labor. So remember I said, the key thing that's going to start triggering the Underground Railroad is those two laws. One, in Maryland, you're a slave for life, and if your mother's a slave, you're always going to be a slave, no matter where you go in the United States. And Pennsylvania's law that said, if you come here for 6 months, you're fine. So these Maryland slaves start thinking, do I want to be a slave for life, or do I want to go to Pennsylvania? If I can hide out for 6 months, or I can work, find some friendly Quaker, or some friendly farmer somewhere who will take me in for 6 months, I'm free. So you start getting people who come to Pennsylvania. It's very easy if you're in Maryland to come to Pennsylvania, right? Follow the North Star, or follow the phases of the moon, and just or follow the Susquehanna River, or follow the Susquehanna Trail, and just move into Pennsylvania and hide here. him really caught him. Why'd they come here? A, we're convenient, we're right north of Maryland, of course, with this whole anti-slavery attitude that's starting to pick up here in Pennsylvania. So you've got these freedom seekers who are starting to come across the border. In the late 1700s, they're starting already to move into York County, move into Lancaster County, move into Chester County, and try to blend into the black communities and try to figure out, you know, who's who at that point in time. Now, they have a lot of ways to get to Pennsylvania. There's a ton of pathways. Obviously, as you can see, just some of the many different examples. And one of the leading ways in the early days is the highway. I mean, you had a major thoroughfare that went from Baltimore to York. It's called the Susquehanna Trail. Didn't have I-83 in those days, of course, we had the trail. So many of these African-American people worked as teamsters. They worked on the highways, building them, maintaining them, constructing them. They certainly knew where Pennsylvania was, just follow the highway. So that was easy. And if you lived in the smaller communities, Darlington, places like that, Bel Air, again, roads led to York County or to Lancaster County. So it was pretty simple, just follow the highways. Of course, once you got here, there was that big river you had to worry about, Susquehanna River. But there's a lot of ferry boats there around the river, and most of the ferry boat drivers were African-American people. Free blacks in most cases, some of whom may have been escaped slaves, and they were certainly sympathetic to the idea. So if you get to the ferry crossings, you could usually find somebody in the middle of the night that would run a special ferry crossing and would make sure you got across. And so there's all kinds of different, you know, images and thoughts on people crossing the Susquehanna River to get there freer. Another way that people came into York County was the canal boats. The canals ran from Havana Grace, Maryland, up to Wrightsville. Again, follow the canal. It's right by the river. Often the canal boat employees, again, were African Americans, free blacks, many of whom had connections in Maryland, some of whom had family, some of whom were born in Maryland, some of whom were probably, again, escaped slaves who came here. Again, if you find employment for 6 months, canal boats are a great way to do it. Well, Marylanders get really upset because slaves are not cheap. Slaves are expensive in those days, and now you've got your slaves running off to Pennsylvania. So here's one Virginia owner puts this ad in Philadelphia paper. Slaves of this state, Virginia, generally supposedly may obtain their freedom by going to Pennsylvania, makes it highly probable that he's in some part of the state. That's one of the first ads I can find from a slave owner in the South who posts in a northern newspaper, in this case the Philadelphia paper, saying that my slave's run away and he's coming to your area. We think he's there. So while this is going on, by the way, York, even though Pennsylvania has outlawed the importing of slaves, whereas it's still legal by itself, people. So here's an ad in New York Borough, January 26, 1789, to be sold. Like a Negro girl about 15 years of age, she's had the smallpox and measles, so she's health-wise is okay now. She's duly registered. Remember, I said you had to be registered, right? So this girl's duly registered. The owners pay the taxes on it. He has no other reason for disposing of her but one of employment. So the owner's lost his job and now cannot afford to have the slave, has already paid the taxes for it, and wants to sell it. Love this. 1 year's credit will be given an approved security. You can, American Express, don't leave home without it. You can buy a slave on credit, on layaway, in effect, and make the payments on the slave, and you can use the slave in the meantime, and you layaway, for heaven's sakes, on a slave. Further particulars may be known by applying to the printers hereof. So this was the York Gazette, a newspaper at that time. Well, Maryland and Virginia and North Carolina are very upset about the fact that everybody's running off to Pennsylvania, and Pennsylvania's laws are saying, just come here for 6 months and you're free. And they finally go to Congress and they say, look, this is ridiculous. You, the United States government, you need to do something about the slave issue, because our laws and the North's laws are totally different. Laws in New York, in New Jersey, in Ohio, well, at this point in time, not Ohio, but certainly New England states. And so the United States Congress gets involved. They pass this very weird law, very unusual. It's called the Fugitive Slave Act of 1793. It doesn't have a lot of firepower behind it, but it's Congress's attempt to try to peaceify the states and to keep Maryland and Virginia and North Carolina happy with relationships with the North. So now what this says is, it's kind of a compromise. Because in the past, Maryland's like, well, hey, you Pennsylvania, you gotta find, you know, you gotta have your sheriffs, you have your judges take care of this problem, and your sheriffs have to go out and find the slaves and bring them back to Virginia. And of course, Pennsylvania's like, no, time out. We didn't ask for these people to come across the border. So you, Virginia, North Carolina, you send your sheriffs up here, and you come get your own slaves at your expense. So Congress rules in favor of the North on that first bullet point, and the Northerners are happy with that bullet point because now the Marylanders and the Southerners have to pay all their expenses. So you're going to come into Pennsylvania, you're going to come into New Jersey, you're going to come into New York, you're going to come into Massachusetts, and you're going to buy hotel rooms, and you're going to buy meals, and you're going to pay for the lodging of your slave in the jail, and you're going to pay all of his expenses. It's a moneymaker for the Northern states. Pretty good moneymaker, in fact. What the North doesn't like is the second part. It's a $500 fine. That is a massive amount of money in 1793. It's a lot of money now, but it was a ton of money then. So you got fined $500 and to pay court costs if you're obstructing the arrest. So if you're doing anything to stop the sheriff from finding those slaves, if you're rescuing the captured, if you're going to have him help you, if you go down to Maryland and grab a slave and bring the slave back, that's a big time problem. Big problem. Now, if they come to your house, it's an equal problem. If you hide the slaves, you never set foot in Maryland, but they come to your door and they knock on your door and you open the door and you fed them and you put them in your barn overnight, that's illegal. So the government said that's $500. Here's the kicker. See who got all the money? The slave owner. So, you know what starts happening? Some of the slave owners start saying, my slave escaped. No, he didn't. Comes into Pennsylvania, finds a black person on the street, hey, that's my slave. Well, okay. Haul him into trial. Judge releases him. You get $500 from the government for that. And your slave never escaped. You know, it becomes a racket, a scheme, a scandal. So this law has got some strange side effects. The other thing that reinforced, though, was the Southern laws. Again, Maryland law. Children born to fugitive slave mothers are slaves. Fugitive slave mothers. So anywhere in Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, Maryland, Delaware, whenever a slave went, anywhere in the United States, their children were always slaves for life. So in effect, they struck down Pennsylvania's law that said if you live here for 6 months, you're free. So there's a lot of problems. There's a lot of race relations, a lot of race riots occur in York. They have a lot of big time problems. Actually, part of York is burned down in a revolt of African-American individuals. The governor has to call in the state militia, put York under martial law, put a travel ban on York. And they end up putting several black people in jail over this whole issue. But what it does is, again, it starts the death knell for slavery in York County. By 1810, there's only 22 slaves left in the entire county. But you can still buy and sell. This is one of the last ads, by the way, that appears in the York newspaper in 1811. Negro wench, 5 years to serve with a boy 2 years old, mulatto girl, age 4 years, offered the highest bidder on Wednesday, April 3rd, at the house of Jacob up in the borough of York, March 27th, 1811. So you're still buying and selling human beings on Market Street in York in 1811. So slavery is still going on. Now, here's another great point. Farmers, particularly in the southern part of the state, start renting slaves. You can't buy slaves, you can sell them. But as a Pennsylvanian, you cannot buy a slave, you can sell them. But you gotta have a Marylander or somebody come up and buy them. But it's fascinating. So the farmers along the border start renting slaves, and ads start appearing in the newspapers renting slaves. You can rent them for a week, rent slaves for a month, rent a slave for a year, and the rates were negotiable. It was whatever you thought you could get as a slave owner. So if you had excess slaves, in your plantation, maybe you didn't have meat this year for as many slaves as last year because some of your crops were not as good this year, or you're planting something else, you can rent your slave to a Pennsylvania and make some money for that slave for the year. And other people would rent the slaves or hire them. And remember, 6 months, they still thought that, even though the federal law had put that down, a lot of folks here simply hired the slaves and said, this is my back field. Start walking and never stop. And the slaves would just walk on into northern Pennsylvania because the slave owners deliberately bought them to set them loose in Pennsylvania. And in fact, what's fascinating about that is black men, free black men in Pennsylvania, would go down to Baltimore, would buy slaves, and bring them back to Pennsylvania and set them free. It's pretty common. In fact, many of those people you bought were your own wives and children, or your brother, or your parents. And you just bring them up in Pennsylvania, and yeah, you're free. I just buy your freedom. So that worked out fairly well. But Baltimore Countyans don't like this whole thing. And what really starts this hatred over the issue of slavery that starts here is this legal issue in 1821. It's a fascinating case. A Maryland state legislator comes into York County under the Fugitive Slave Law of 1793, and he does everything proper. My slaves run away, here's the sheriff, here's all the legal documents, gonna put them in jail. Well, the abolitionists of York County said, you got time out. This girl's mother's been living in Pennsylvania most of her life. You know, this child was born in Pennsylvania. So if his child's born in Pennsylvania, remember our law? If you're born after 1780, well after 1808, remember that 28-year period? It's 1821. So if you're born in Pennsylvania, you're free. You're free. No matter what Congress says, Pennsylvania's law is still on the books. So the judge not only refused to release the slave, the judge throws the Maryland state legislator in prison, and they're going to try him for criminal kidnapping of a child. Anybody know what the penalty was in Pennsylvania for that? Death by hanging. So Pennsylvania is in effect going to hang a Maryland state legislator. You think the governor of Maryland appreciates that? The governor of Maryland calls out the state militia, and the governor of Pennsylvania says, well, okay, fine. He sends the state militia to Shrewsbury. And for a very brief moment in time, you have Pennsylvania's army and Maryland's army looking, you know, only 10 miles or so apart, ready to move into the other state if they needed to, if the governor ordered. We came that close to a civil war between Maryland and Pennsylvania, not a national civil war, but a regional civil war over this very issue in 1821. Finally, cooler heads prevail, and Pennsylvania is convinced to drop all the charges. Guy goes free. Oh, by the way, remember the slave? The jailer of York County, a guy named William Yoakum, I think was his name, left the door open that night, and the slaves were never seen again. He just disappears into the night, gone into the Pennsylvania sunset, never, ever to be seen again. Well, while this is going on, the governor of Maryland, Charles Ridgely, anybody ever been to this place? This is Towson. If you've never been to this, it's a national park, right off the 695 Delaney Valley Road exit. Go there. Towson is a national park. It's the largest remaining slave plantation in all of Maryland. You can go there and you can see the buildings the slaves lived in. You can see the giant mansion they built for the governor and his family. They had over 500 people enslaved on this plantation. And a lot of them just simply ran off to York. So this guy all the time is putting ads in the York newspapers about trying to find the slaves. I mean, they're in Yo, they're in Dallastown, they're in Peach Bottom, they're in Hanover, there are slaves in Shrewsbury, they're in York. I mean, his slaves are just running everywhere, and he's trying to find them and get rid of them. Well, while this is going on, so here in York County, yes, people were trying to find the slaves, and you could turn them back into their owners in Maryland for money. Because the Baltimore people or the Virginia people would put ads in the local York newspapers. If you find my slave, I'll give you $25. I'll give you $50. And so you could hire a professional slave catcher who would come find your slave for you. And there are three slave catchers I want to talk about. The first known nationally recognized slave catcher in York County is Bill Otto. Bill's a plasterer. He's 6'4". He's a former British sailor. Jumped ship in Baltimore. Lived for a while in New York and then Philadelphia. Then moves to Hanover. Baltimore to New York to Philadelphia to Hanover. He may be the only person in history with that resume. But he ends up in Hanover. He captures a bunch of slaves and a lot of free people as well, we think. And ironically, the United States Navy's finally going to grab this guy when he's escorting a slave ship, which was illegal at that point in time, and throw him in prison. Manchester. Where were we at? We're about Wolf, right? Just down the roads, Manchester, okay? Here's John Yeoman, the postmaster of Manchester. Oh, by the way, since Mount Wolf didn't have a post office, then he's your postmaster too. In that period, John Yeoman, he managed a Cadore's furnace and a nail factory up in York Haven, and he would watch for slaves crossing Conewago Creek. Because the slaves, that was a really dangerous place to cross. There were only a few places that were safe, and this guy knew where they were. And so he would look for the slaves. The most notorious was the Fetro family. I came today right by their graves. The Fetro family are buried at that little church at the intersection of the trail and Canal Road. You know what I'm talking about? Quickles Church. Lutheran Church, right? So the Fetro family, who are members of that congregation, Fetro family are slave catchers. And they are involved in a huge issue here in York County in Lewisbury. So we have Joe Garrison's house right here. We have the Quaker meeting house here. Remember I said the Quakers are violently anti-slavery. And so the Quakers in the Lewisbury, Newburytown area were always buying slaves, renting slaves, helping slaves live there for 6 months, doing all kinds of stuff to hide the slaves from their masters. And the Fetro brothers and their two sons, so there's two brothers and two sons, they are coming up trying to find them. And in one horrible instance, at Joe Garrison's farm, the Fetro clan from Conewago Township show up. The slave is upstairs in the house. The house is still there, by the way, Old Quaker Road. He kind of jumps from the window. He's shot by one of the Fetro brothers. He's dragged into the barn. He's dying. They're going to pull 16 buckshot out of his back. They're going to haul him down to Baltimore. He's going to die on the route. And they're going to put a sign up saying to the rest of your slaves, this is what happens if you go to Pennsylvania. If you run to Pennsylvania, you're going to get killed. Look at this body. If you run to Pennsylvania, this is what's going to happen to you. And they use him as an example, poor George, dead in Pennsylvania. Well, that infuriates the Quakers. And the Quakers just go ballistic over this issue, and they start coalescing their efforts to move people out of York County, because York County's dangerous. We've got to get them across the river into Lancaster County, and this is where the Underground Railroad begins in this area, is to get them across that river. And the first known Quakers to start moving people across the river, and what becomes the Underground Railroad is William Wright. And William Wright's a Quaker, lives in Columbia. His sister lives in this house. This is High Bluff, which is in Wrightsville, which is the house that's been in all the news that people were trying to save, unfortunately, because an industrialist wants to knock this thing down. And it's the first documented Underground Railroad house west of the Susquehanna River in the United States of America. We're going to knock it down. It's in York County. The owner, Jonathan Mifflin, who was the brother-in-law of William Wright, sends the Quakers across, or sends the escaped slaves across the river into Columbia. He uses a free black man to row them across. Remember, he said a lot of these ferry boat operators and rowboat operators are free blacks. And then the Quakers are going to take them to Burning Hand, where they're going to take them to Gap, where they're going to take them to Paradise, or one of these other Quaker communities, you know, and they're going to move them to Philadelphia eventually. And from Philadelphia, you're going to get them to New York City, and you're just going to get them as far away from Maryland as you can. And this is where the Underground Railroad begins, at least in our area. So, Pennsylvania, in defiance of United States law in 1826, accelerates the Underground Railroad by passing a personal liberty law. And it says nobody can be brought into Pennsylvania to be held in slavery. Any runaways had to be held. There had to be a trial now. You had to have a warrant under oath. You had to have evidence. You just can't come up here and snatch anybody you want to just because you said he's a slave. And you most certainly can't shoot them in the back by any stretch of imagination. Anybody who took a fugitive slave from Pennsylvania without doing all this stuff, criminal kidnapping, death by hanging. So that's Pennsylvania's retort to the United States government. You guys can do what you want with this fugitive slave law. If you come to Pennsylvania, this is what's going to happen. You're going to follow this law religiously, or we are going to execute you. we're going to try you for criminal kidnapping. And they made no bones about that fact. Maryland appreciates this. Virginia, South Carolina, North Carolina, no, no, no. What they happens about the middle of this is Virginia, remember, Virginia's laws are similar to Maryland. You can't let them go without direct legal action. Twice, Virginia passes special laws. You can free your slave by this date, this year, they're free. The only caveat is they have to leave Virginia. Can't happen here. We don't want free black people, former slaves, living among our slave population. You gotta get rid of them, take them to Pennsylvania. So wagon trains start moving into York County twice, once in 1819, again in 1827, and these Virginia slaves move here. That's the beginning of York's black slave population. That's the beginning of Wrightsville's black population. York in particular gets a lot of these people. So here comes the Prigg versus Pennsylvania case. I said it was going to take just a couple minutes to talk about this. This is what tests the United States laws. Jerry Morgan is a free-born black man. Jerry Morgan marries a slave woman, Margaret. She's the property of John and Margaret Ashmore, named for her owner's wife. Little Margaret grows up a slave girl. Well, John Ashmore, her owner, doesn't really care. And this new young couple set up shop in Pennsylvania, and they're going to start a family in Pennsylvania. John Ashmore's fine. I don't need it. Plenty of slaves. I can't get rid of the slaves by law. But if you want to move to Pennsylvania, fine. Just go. Well, John Ashmore dies, and the evil son-in-law shows up. The evil son-in-law, Nathan Bemis, goes to the widow, grieving widow, and says, you know, I don't know how I'm going to pay for you. I've got the bill here as well that your husband owned. I think we need to collect all your husband's slaves and go sell them. We need the money. So he convinces the grieving widow to hire a professional team of slave catchers from Maryland and an attorney, because again, you got to have an attorney. So the attorney came to York with the three people. They file all the right paperwork. According to Pennsylvania's new laws, they file all the right paperwork. They do everything legally. In the middle of the night, they go down to Lower Chancery Township, just outside of Airville. You guys know where Airville is? Right outside of Airville. They go in the middle of the night, and they grab this lady and her six kids, put them on a wagon, kicking and screaming, and they're going to drag them back to Peach Bottom. From there, they're going to find a judge who will certify everything's legal. Well, they can't find the right judge, they don't get the right signatures, and they end up in Maryland anyway. And Pennsylvania goes ballistic. Pennsylvania sends the sheriff down to Bel Air, and they're going to arrest the attorney and the three slave catchers. They haul them back to New York, and they're going to hang them. They're going to try them for criminal kidnapping under that Pennsylvania law of 1826, and they're going to execute it. Maryland says, time out. Can't do that. Can't do that. Our law says that that's a fugitive slave mother. She went to Pennsylvania. Her kids are still slaves. We don't care where they live. The United States Congress says these are slaves. And Pennsylvania responds with, we don't care about national law. We're Pennsylvania. And our law says these people are free. They're born in Pennsylvania after 1808. They're free. Well, Maryland and Pennsylvania decide to take it to the United States Supreme Court after months of legal documents. These are just some of the legal documents that I've uncovered. Letters between the governors, letters between the sheriffs, letters between the congressmen, letters between the mayor of Bel Air, the mayor of York, Chief Burgess. All kinds of letters going back and forth, some of which are in Bel Air, some of which are in York, some of which are in Harrisburg, some of which are in Annapolis. But you know, put all this stuff together, and it paints a very ugly picture that these two states are still doing this. But these two states' laws just do not agree whatsoever. So, to make a long story short, they decided to compromise. We're going to send this to the United States Supreme Court. And we're going to let the Supreme Court decide whether Maryland's right or whether Pennsylvania's right. So Pennsylvania, go ahead and try them. Just don't kill them. So they're tried in York County, in York, in the Common Pleas Court, and they're found guilty. Pennsylvania Supreme Court procedurally upholds the execution, upholds the sentence, and says all four men are guilty. But they're not going to hang them. Remember, this is going to let it all play out. So now Pennsylvania's highest court has declared these four people are criminals. They are guilty of six counts of kidnapping, and everything's fine. Well, in the middle of all this, now national abolitionists start coming to Pennsylvania while they're waiting on the Supreme Court. So like any guys, your school kids, if you start studying the abolitionist movement, every major abolitionist in American history comes to York. You know, William Lloyd Garrison shows up. Garrett Smith shows up. They all come here. You know, Louisa May Alcott shows up. Lucretia Mott shows up. C.C. Burley shows up. I mean, these are the big shots of the American abolitionist movement. They all come to York, every single one of them. And they're making fiery speeches in York, anti-slavery, anti-South. And they start demanding, William Lloyd Garrison makes a fiery speech on the steps of the courthouse demanding immediate abolition of slavery nationwide. And a group of Marylanders, supported by some York Countyans, throw rocks at him and try to stone him. Thaddeus Stevens shows up from Lancaster County with Reverend John Blanchard. They're going to get stoned, rocks and bottles. Again, they actually do get stoned in Harrisburg, and Blanchard gets hurt. But you can just see this whole epicenter of what's going on. Supreme, oh, by the way, Maryland finally allows Mrs. Morgan and the six children to be sold into slavery. They're gone. They're never heard from again. Jerry Morgan, the freeborn black man, is on a canal boat ride from Harrisburg to Columbia, having pleaded his case with the governor, Joseph Whitner, I think his name was, of Pennsylvania. He slips off the canal boat and drowns. So the whole Morgan family's gone before this thing gets done. But York decides to follow through, and Pennsylvania's Attorney General, Wilfred Johnson. It's so important to Pennsylvania, we send the state attorney general to plead the case in front of the Supreme Court. United States Supreme Court, Prigg versus Pennsylvania, in a law that changes America forever, the Supreme Court overturns Pennsylvania. It says, York's wrong, Pennsylvania Supreme Court's wrong, Maryland's right. All of Pennsylvania's laws immediately struck down. Every single northern state that has a personal liberty law was struck down. All of them. The Marylanders got what they wanted. The Virginians got what they wanted. The North Carolinians got what they wanted. Ha ha! The northern states turn around and say, well, forget you guys. We're just going to pass our own law, new laws. Pennsylvania passes a brand new law that says the moment a slave crosses the Mason-Dixon line, they're free forever. You know, one toe in Pennsylvania, you're free. Take that, Maryland. Take that, United States government. We're Pennsylvania. We are Penn State. So government can't do anything about it. So in York County, you really have three positions. You're either an abolitionist, you're a copyright, or you're pro-slavery. Church that splits right in two over this issue. Here in York County, there's a lot of these Negro conventions going on, free black community. You got this whole increasing abolitionist movement that starts up here. But one of the issues is we're still so tightly connected to Maryland. Baltimore is so important to Southern York County in particular because of the agriculture and the trade and York's merchants and Baltimore's merchants. So a lot of people here are pretty sympathetic to what's going on in Maryland. They have a lot of attitudes here. York, I like this. York was distinctly northern but not bitterly anti-Southern. I mean, we're in the north. We're certainly not anti-slavery by any stretch of imagination. So here's another one. I like this. 100 white men working in, there's enough labor. So there's an ad that appears in the York paper that says, we free the black people, they're going to take our jobs. We can't have that. We don't have enough jobs now, so we can't free these people. So you got all these different stuff going on. And while this happens, the Underground Railroad really takes off. So here in York County, here's the major United States routes of the Underground Railroad. The Star is my home in Southern Ohio. Where I grew up, my family was involved in the Underground Railroad. We believe from tradition, Ohio is the main part of the Underground Railroad. But look over here. Here's Pennsylvania, Southern Pennsylvania, York County, Chester County, Lancaster County. So here's the routes coming into York County. First route went to Gettysburg, split over to York, or went up to Lewisbury. Remember, I said Lewisbury is the key to this, a lot of this. Coming to Hanover, up to York. Come into Shrewsbury, up to York, come into Stewartstown, up to York through Dallastown, come into Delaware, the only route that didn't go through York, went through Beachbottom and split across the river, and then took them to Christiana, Pennsylvania. But York's dangerous. You can't keep them in York. You got to get them to the river, so you got to take them to Wrightsville, you got to take them to Bainbridge, or take them to Harrisburg. You got to get them on the east side of the river, because there's way too many slave catchers. In fact, down here at Newberrytown, at Maryland Line, there was a huge population of professional slave catchers with bloodhounds and Irish wolfhounds and things like that. So you can see this network starts arising in York County. First, York County conductor I want to talk about briefly is Jonathan Jessup. Anybody been to the Applewood Medical Center? Mm-hmm. Applewood Medical Center is where the Jessup Farm was. Jonathan Jessup becomes the leader of the Underground Railroad movement in southern York County. He will help bring them in from Virginia, bring the escaped slaves up through Maryland. They would come to Apple Hill. He would put them to work in his orchards, and when things looked good, he would then move them to New York to a fellow Quakers, and they would move them out to the river. So Jonathan Jessup, very important. I talk a lot about him in my book. He'd take them in downtown York to this house, the Stavis Grice House, which still exists on Market Street, 322 Market Street. And Amos Grice would be the number one Quaker in downtown York. He would move them to Samuel Willis's house. For those of you familiar with York, Route 30, Burger King, the road that parallels Route 30 beyond south of Burger King is called Willis Lane. There's a small farmhouse now, bed and breakfast in there called the Willis House. That was, again, a major Quaker Underground Railroad stop. And he would take them to Dover, to Dr. Webster Lewis. And from Dover, he would take them on to his dad, who was a doctor in Lewisberry, and then move them from Lewisberry again to Bainbridge, or across the river at Harrisburg. Now, in Hanover, the number one was not a Quaker. We've been talking a lot about Quakers and free blacks. This is Jacob Wirt. Jacob Wirt's house is gone, but he was a very prominent German, typical Pennsylvania Dutchman. He would bring him up Route 116, the old Monocacy Trail, from Hanover into downtown York, and would move him there. Ironically, his house, by the way, is used during the Civil War Battle of Hanover as George Armstrong Custer's headquarters. Churches are involved in the Underground Railroad. Not a lot of records, but this is a Bethlehem Reformed Church on Stealth Road down in Glen Rock. Their congregation was pretty heavily involved. The Moravians here in New York were pretty heavily involved. We also have this guy involved. You guys know where York College is? York College today is on the old Springdale Estate. It was owned by Charlie Barnett. He's an Underground Railroad operator. He's a former state senator. And look at this, he's a United States congressman. While he's in Congress, back home, his staff, free blacks, are helping escaped slaves make it through York into the river. That's a problem when the United States congressman's involved. Oh, by the way, he's in cahoots with another German, the sheriff of York, William Yoakum. When slaves came into York County, and the Marylanders said the slaves were in Lewisberry or Shrewsbury, he'd take them to Lewisberry. If they said they were in Wrightsville, he'd take them to Thomasville. He would take them wherever the slaves weren't, take them the wrong direction until they figured out the slaves weren't there. And again, there were all kinds of people. The Mifflins, we talked about the Quakers on the river, the Woodyards, the Parnells, a lot of people in the Long Level, Accomack, Wrightsville area. And again, here's Mifflin. Jonathan Mifflin's dead and gone by now, as is his wife, but his kid, Sam Mifflin, a very gifted railroad engineer, takes over. He owns Hydla, same house we showed earlier. He's married to the Hannah Wright from Adams County, so you got those Quakers that are married and still working with the same free black man. So until 1847, that house is still heavily used in the Underground Railroad. Two generations. So this also, by the way, is the first York and only York County two-generation single-family house involved in the Underground Railroad. We're going to knock it down. Henry Grant, a free black man, and a number of free, remember I said there were free blacks in Peach Bottom? You know, all the 22 blacks or whatever it was, they all got freed eventually, and now Peach Bottom, Delta, Fawn Grove, that area, very heavily black in this period, and most of those guys are heavily involved in the Underground Railroad. So a lot of these folks, again, are putting people on those ferry boats and taking them across the river into southern Lancaster County for Quarryville, places like that, moving them through to Christiana through the valley. And the United States Congress finally says, you know, our laws are enough's enough. Enough's enough. We got to figure this out once and for all. So in 1850, in a huge series of compromises, you got all these issues going on. You had the westward expansion of slavery. You got new territories that are going to come in freer than they're going to come in slave. You got this whole escaped slave thing going on. And Henry Clay, John C. Calhoun, and Daniel Webster brokered the Great Compromise of 1850, among other people. Stephen Douglas, plenty of people involved in this. So this compromise is going to put a stop to a lot of this stuff short term. By then, 100,000 slaves had escaped, and northern courts weren't doing anything about it, so the Congress now really toughens the laws. Now it's the state's responsibility. No, they changed it. Now it's the federal law. So they're going to send the U.S. Marshals into the states. Any person named a runaway slave or providing shelter, food, or any other assistance allowed was 6 months in federal prison. 6 months in federal prison. And a $1,000 fine, we'll just make it up to now worth $26,000. You didn't pay that in cash, by the way. So now the York County's got a real problem. Do we help these escaped slaves? Do we ignore the problem? When they knock on our door, we just hope they don't knock on my door. Or do I help them become a bounty hunter and try to turn these folks in for money? Everything hits the head on September 11, 1851, when a group of slaves who escaped through York County, through Shrewsbury, into York, they've been helped by the network. They're going to move all the way into Christiana. Major riot occurs in Christiana. The slave owner is killed. He's a deputy United States Marshal, and everything hits the fan, and most of York County's black members of the Underground Railroad head for Canada. So is most of the Underground Railroad people involved. United States government, by the way, tries these folks for treason, finds them innocent, and everything continues on. Recognize this house is Jacob Brillinger's house. That, of course, is over by the hospital, soon to be obsolete. Small memorial hospital. Supposedly this guy's heavily involved. Again, we can't prove a lot of this. Shrewsbury, a free black man named Samuel Berry, gets heavily involved, becomes the number one when the Jessup family has to get him from Maryland, so he actually gets involved in helping bring the slaves, process them in Shrewsbury, and then take them on to where Apple Hill Medical Center is today. The number one conductor in the 1850s and 60s, he's not active until late 1840s, we think, maybe a little earlier. But his name's William C. Goodrich. He lives in downtown York. He's the wealthiest African American man in York County. Owns a really nice mansion. Hides slaves in a cellar. Has a free black man that helps him take him to the river. He's a barber. He's a great story. He's actually born a slave in Carroll County, Maryland. Is free as a teenager, comes to York, starts cutting hair, starts selling hair tonic, guaranteed to restore your balding hair. Sells a lot of his hair tonic, becomes phenomenally wealthy. His wife's a really good cook, she makes great candy, and people start coming to the barber shop store to buy candy. Turns out that they just might as well sell candy too, starts selling other trinkets. The next thing you know, he's got a huge, still 5-story-high emporium on the square of downtown York and becomes phenomenally wealthy for his period of time. Guy also owns 13 railroad cars, and look what he does to the railroad cars. He has a false end on the railroad cars, or sometimes false two ends, and he puts the escaped slaves inside the railroad cars in downtown York and hustles them out via rail to Wrightsville. The trains are disconnected to Wrightsville. The mules and oxen team and draft horses are going to carry these railroad cars across the world's longest covered bridge in Wrightsville into Columbia. They're going to be hooked back up into a train, hooked to an engine, and they're going to be taken to Philadelphia to William Still, who's the number one conductor in the state of Pennsylvania. And William Still will process them. He'll send them to New York City to Howard Sidney Gay. Howard Sidney Gay will then send them to upstate New York to Frederick Douglass and people like that. And then they're going to move them to Buffalo, and from Buffalo they're going to take them to Canada. And that's the escape route in the 1850s. You've got to get them out of the U.S. Move the freedom seekers to Canada, because that new law is so bad that anywhere you go in the United States, you're not safe. So everybody starts heading for Canada at that point in time. As I said, we don't know how many people. Some accounts are that he helped thousands of people go through York. We do know he helped John Brown's raiders escape from Harper's Ferry and hide one of the black men to help John Brown in the raid of Harper's Ferry. Here's his lines. Now, a lot of these ads people are placing, we'll talk about, I've got one package, large package. Well, that's probably a large black man. I've got 4 small packages accompanied by a medium-sized package. That was a mother with 4 children. And there would be, that was the manifest in the railroad. And again, those boxes would be loaded on and they'd be going out. There were actually people that mailed themselves to York Just like there's a famous story of a guy who mailed himself to Philadelphia named Box Brown, there were people who mailed themselves to York. There's one case where a lady goes in a piano box, big, huge piano box, pays for herself to be shipped to York to the attention of William C. Goodrich, apparently. And here in York, when they open the piano case, she steps out, there was a box, and she's gone into the Underground Railroad network forever. She was basically, you know, was mailed into York by freight traffic. All the way to the Civil War finally stops the question. One thing that people miss, though, is the Emancipation Proclamation did not free the slaves in Maryland. Emancipation Proclamation only freed slaves in states in rebellion to the United States. Slaves in Missouri, slaves in Kentucky, slaves in West Virginia, slaves in Maryland, slaves in Delaware were not freed by the Emancipation Proclamation. So you're still a slave in Maryland throughout the Civil War. And so the Underground Railroad continues until the 1860s. But you guys remember the New York Valley Inn. Middle of the Civil War, one of the last known major escapes of slaves from Baltimore County. They ended up at the old Valley Inn. And New York Valley Inn, they're taken from there to Wrightsville, to the river. It's not until November of 1864 that Maryland passes out the Emancipation. That officially ends the Underground Railroad between York and Maryland.
Oh, freedom.
Oh!